Now I have tried to give you a generalized definition of force. So force is a result of interaction both internal and external. Say suppose if you have an object A, you can apply a force internally or you can apply a force externally. That is, this object A and this object B is applying a force externally to B. Say suppose there is molecules inside A. So this molecules is applying force internally to A. So in this way we can understand force to be something which happens because of the interaction of two, because of the interaction between two or more objects. Now a single object A, say suppose a single object A will never experience a force, unless there is a second party, or more. It can experience force either because of the interaction with B or because of the combined interaction with B, C, D and many more. So this is how we can understand that force is a result of interaction both internally and externally between two or more objects. Now in order to, as I've said, in order to experience force, you need at least two objects, two or more objects in the form of a push or a pull. Either this will pull you towards itself or this will push you away from itself. And what we have to keep in mind is that I've often found students getting confused. Say suppose this is in this direction and this is in this direction. So how will this pull? This will always pull in a straight line. This will always pull you in a straight line. This will never pull you in a curved line. This will always have an interaction in a straight line. So this either will pull you or this either will push you. So you can take this definition of force. That is, what is force? Force is a result of interaction, both internal and external, between two or more objects in the form of push or a pull. So by this definition, we can move forward into understanding the mathematical concept of force. Now, you will often see F equals to MA. Now, above F, they have given this sign. And above A, they have given this particular sign. So, if you are getting confused with this vector notation, I kindly advise students to look into the chapters of vectors. But I'll try to explain you vectors in a much more simpler way in this particular video. But if you want a more elaborate explanation of vectors, I kindly advise to please look at the previous video. So vectors is something which has a magnitude, and also has a direction. So we can say that force, how much force are you applying? This force F, what is the quantity? Either you are giving a gentle push or you are giving a severe push. That is, you are putting effort into pushing, either a gentle or a severe push. That is the magnitude. What is the quantity? That is magnitude of force. And the SI unit of force is Newton. And the CGS unit of force is dyne. This is dyne. One is Newton and the other is dyne. And if you try to understand the relation between Newton and dyne, you can simply have this particular expression. That is, 1 Newton is equal to 10 to the power 5 dyne. So this is all about the SI unit of force and the mathematical expression of force. So let's understand the mathematical way of understanding what exactly is force. Mathematically, we can understand force to be F equals to ma, where m is mass, a is your acceleration, and F is force. Now let's take a example. Say suppose I have taken an object A. Now I run and I push this object A with a force F. It's in the ground. And I push the object A. Now there are certain conditions that we have to keep in mind. The conditions that we are considering is that there is no friction. There is no pressure. Say suppose atmospheric or water, there is no such pressure. So we are considering the whole scenario to be ideal. Now what is ideal? Ideal is a condition where there is no hindrance. Ideal condition. Now I often find students asking me this question, sir, when you explain this in the video and when we try to do this in real life, the results are quite different. Why is this so? The answer is because when you are understanding this mathematically, that is, we are not taking the dynamic conditions. We are never considering the dynamic conditions. In dynamic conditions, you consider all the forces that comes into play. Say, for example, if you are keeping an object in the ground, you have a frictional force. You have this frictional force because of your gravity. Because of gravity, you have frictional force. Plus also you are surrounded by atmosphere. You are surrounded by a blanket of atmosphere which puts a atmospheric pressure, to the object. So these are known as the dynamic conditions. So we are not considering the dynamic condition, we are only considering the ideal conditions where all these other factors which comes into play gets nullified. So this is the reason why your mathematical expressions and your real life experiments are quite different. So coming back to the mathematical expression, that is ideally F equals to ma, where m is a mass. You have an object say A and it has a mass. That is, it has certain weight and it covers certain space. It has a mass. Now you are applying a force F. To this particular object. So what will happen? This starts moving while you're applying the force, that is, you're continuously applying the force F. This object starts moving and it moves with the acceleration. Now that is, acceleration means it will have a constant velocity change towards the direction of the applied force. Now I have used the word towards the direction of the applied force. This is force F. If you are applying a force F, then the body starts moving towards this direction. That is, this object is moving towards the direction of the applied force. So mathematically, the acceleration A we are giving with this arrow, this is acceleration A, will happen towards the direction of the applied force. So this is how we understand the term F equals to ma. F equals to ma is the term force equals to mass into acceleration.